What is a boundary layer? We talk about boundary layers when we're discussing either internal or external. And in some ways, they are exactly the same, and in other ways, they differ. So the overall description is it's this thin region. It's on the surface of a body, and it's where viscous effects are important. So outside the boundary layer, we can consider the flow in viscid. So how does this occur? Well, you have fluid, and we'll consider this internal flow, and it enters with a uniform velocity. And as it moves through, the viscous effects are going to cause it to stick to the wall. And the reason this is because of the no-slip condition. So let me try and draw a pipe with this. So let's say here you're entering a pipe or any kind of internal flow. And as you go along the pipe here, the velocity profile is changing because of this growing boundary layer. So let's call this the boundary layer. Remember, this is a circular pipe. And in the boundary layer, we have viscous effects that are important. However, in here, we have an inviscid core. And one of the reasons that could be considered important is the fact that the flow in there is inviscid implies that we could actually use Bernoulli's in that core. When finally these boundary layers thicken to completely fill the pipe, we get our velocity profile. So when this happens, we get what is known as fully developed flow. So what that means is the flow does not change in the direction of the flow. I guess the best way to put that is mathematically. The change in u with respect to x equals zero, or the change in u with respect to z, if that's how you have your coordinate system, is zero. The change in u with respect to r, however, is not zero, and you can tell that from the velocity profile. So until it becomes fully developed, that's what's known as the entrance or entry length, entrance region. For the rest of the pipe now, it is fully developed. So how do we determine what this entry length is? Well, this entry length, or dimensionless entry length, divided it by D, is a function of the Reynolds number, regardless of whether the flow is laminar or turbulent. And it's been found that if the flow is laminar, this L over D equals 0.06 times the Reynolds number. However, if the flow is turbulent, this entry length divided by D equals 4.4 Reynolds to the 1/6. So there we're looking at a pipe. Let's say instead we look at a flat plate. So this is what we would consider external flow. And again, for a flat plate, the purpose of the boundary layer is to allow the fluid to change its velocity from its upstream value, which is this uniform velocity profile, and we'll call this u, to zero at the surface. So what happens is you get from the edge, you get this boundary layer that grows, and then when it becomes turbulent, it jumps and grows some more. And we define this height of this boundary layer as del. And del is considered the y at which our velocity little u equals 99% of our free stream velocity. So above this area, we still have, beyond the boundary layer, we have our uniform or upstream velocity. So the question is, how do we find this height of our boundary layer? So for laminar flow, it's been determined that our boundary layer length or width equals 5 times the square root of the kinematic viscosity times x over our free stream velocity. And what this allows us to do is find the width of this boundary layer at any x in the on the flat plate. We also have a similar boundary layer width for turbulent flow. And here this del divided by x equals 0.370 divided by Reynolds sub x to the 1/5. So again, we are able to find the width or the height of the boundary layer at any x, regardless of whether we're in laminar or turbulent flow. Sometimes we would like to know what the velocity is. So we want to find out what that u is. In order to determine that, the Navier-Stokes equations were simplified, taking into account boundary layer properties, such that v is very much greater than u, and d dx is very much, or v is very much less than u, and d dx is very much less than d dy. And that's because since the boundary layer is thin, the component of velocity normal to the plate is going to be smaller than that's parallel, and the rate of change of any parameter across the boundary layer should be much greater than that along the direction of the flow. So we simplify the Navier-Stokes equations to make this the boundary layer equations, and these cannot be solved analytically. However, they have been solved numerically, and we therefore have solutions based on a similarity variable. So the similarity variable takes into consideration not only, and this is the kinematic viscosity, the x direction, it also takes into account the y direction. And we use this similarity variable, and again, remember, this was figured out numerically, to define this derivative of this function of our similarity variable, which equals u, little u, divided by big U. And so what that allows us to do is at any x, we can at any y find our similarity variable. And then using a table, which is laminar flow across or along a flat plate, this is also known as the Blasius solution. We have a table that uses eta, and from that you can find your little u over big U. So for example, if you have an eta of 2.8, which you calculated based on your free stream velocity, your x and your y, you would find that little u over your free stream velocity would be 0.8115. And clearly these numbers are not going to be greater than 1 because your velocity at any point is not going to be greater than the free stream velocity. We can then use this number such that u equals 0.8115 times our free stream velocity.